Hello friends, good morning. We'll just be starting in a couple of minutes. Hello once again friends, very good morning and thank you all for joining us today on this bright sunny morning and choosing to spend your time with Renewsys. I hope you and your loved ones are safe. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, I'm Vinel and I lead marketing and communications here at Renewsys. Renewsys is the first integrated manufacturer of solar PV modules and its key components, that is encapsulants, backsheets and solar PV cells. And this is the 9th week that we've been conducting these webinars. Thanks to your support and encouragement that has really kept us energized. We hope to continue to have these webinars going forward as well. And we will explore new ways to stay connected with you as the lockdown eases across India and people get back to normal work. So today's webinar is a second part of a two-part series that will be uncovering the secrets of semiconductors and solar cells. Taking us through this topic is Dr. Sarvanand Somasundaram. He leads semiconductor research for Renewsys. We also have with us Mr. Bhupendra Rawat, who heads business development for Renewsys. And shortly we will have a couple of others joining us, including Mr. Sandeep Devbakhtuni, who leads module reliability, and Mr. Nandkumar Pai, who is the CEO, Cells and Modules. So we'd like to begin quickly. Just a reminder once again, since this session will also be a little technical, in case you have any queries, please keep typing them into the Q&A section. And after every set of slides is completed, when Dr. Sarvanand takes a break, he will give us an opportunity to put those questions before him. And we'll try and answer it there and then instead of keeping them all for the end of the session. So please type in your name followed by your question and we'll address it at the earliest possible. So without further delay, I'll request Dr. Sarvanand to please take us through this session. Good morning, Dr. Sarvanand.
Yeah, good morning, Vinay. Good morning, everyone. This is the second session of our previous webinar on understanding solar PV cells. In this webinar, we will be focusing on PV cell manufacturing and its emerging technologies. Before getting into the technical discussion, I'll brief about Renewsys. Renewsys is the first integrated manufacturer of solar PV modules and its key components such as encapsulants, backsheets and solar PV cells. In this presentation, let us have a view on PV technologies, which will give you an overall picture about PV technologies. Subsequently, we will go through the process and manufacturing of silicon solar cells by using standard aluminum BSF technology. Once it is done, we will go through the advanced PV silicon solar technology Before concluding this session, let us have a look at the current efficiency status and challenges in silicon PV technologies. In last webinar, we had seen different types of materials and semiconductors, how we are making a PN junction, and what is the role of PN junction in silicon solar cell. And we have ended the last webinar with operations of solar cell. This slide gives you the overall picture of PV technologies. PV technologies has been broadly classified into thin-film photovoltaic and silicon photovoltaic. Cadmium telluride thin-film solar cells and copper indium gallium selenide solar cells are the major thin-film photovoltaic. In the past few years, perovskite solar cells also play a vital role in thin-film photovoltaic. Silicon photovoltaics has been broadly classified into standard homogeneous emitter technology and heterojunction technology. The standard homogeneous emitter technology and its research has been started in the year 1951. Also, the standard homogeneous emitter technology more basically focused on monocrystalline silicon cells and multicrystalline silicon solar cells. The researchers and the technologies paid much attention on this standard homogeneous emitter technology and arrived with different types of silicon solar cell technology, which are listed out here. Now, as a common man, there will be a question why the wafers have to be converted into a solar cell, because wafers also a semiconductor. Why not wafers has to be used directly into a solar cell? The answer is wafers are either n-type or p-type semiconductor, but the solar cells are the combination of n-type and p-type semiconductor, which gives the PN junction. As discussed last year, this PN junction is the hole responsible for the charge carrier transport in solar cells. Also, the solar cell need to serve the three critical processes like light absorption, carrier generation, and carrier collection. As discussed earlier in this webinar, we will be focusing on the process and manufacturing of silicon solar cells by using standard aluminum BSF technology. Also, we will go through the different types of silicon solar cells. This is the process flow of standard aluminum BSF technology. In general, silicon solar cell process involves chemical process and thermal processes to convert the wafer into silicon solar cell. When we say wafers, the standard aluminum BSF technology uses p-type wafer. However, it uses either mono or multicrystalline silicon wafer as the starting material. This animation will gives you the manufacturing flow of monocrystalline silicon solar cell, mono silicon wafers. This is the method called as Zaporovsky method. The silicon crunches will be molded and it will be pulled out in a single ingot. This ingot will be sliced via either diamond wire or slurry wire, and finally we will arrive the monocrystalline silicon wafer. Similarly, this is the animation which gives you the manufacturing flow of multicrystalline silicon wafer. This method called as the ingot method. Once you arrive with the ingot, and then it will be sliced depending on our needs. This is the pictorial view of monocrystalline and multicrystalline silicon wafer. These wafers will go through the first process called as star damage removal and texturization. In general, what we do in star damage removal, the wafer manufacturers, when they slice the wafer from the ingot, there will be a sawmill on the surface of the silicon wafer. Along with that, when the wafers are getting sliced, the wafer manufacturer use lubricant. These lubricants will leave the metal impurity on surface of silicon. Hence, during the process of star damage removal, we remove the silicon from both the sides of wafer so that the star marks and the metal impurities over the surface will be removed. Along with that, we do the process called texturization. It reduces the reflections of light by making the surface rough. This is the surface morphology of raw silicon wafer. Once the process has been completed, the surface of the textured wafer will be look like this. Once this process has been completed, it will go for a process called doping and diffusion. Addition of foreign atoms is called doping. Here, in this process, we dope the phosphorus over the n-type semiconductor to create p-n junction. PuCl3 is the starting material for doping the phosphorus in a tube column. PuCl3 in a liquid form will be carried into the tube furnace by a carrier nitrogen, and this PuCl3 will decompose into phosphorus pentoxide and residual chlorine. This phosphorus pentoxide will be deposited over the surface of wafer under the edges. In order to get the phosphorus diffused, we slightly elevate the temperature of the furnace so that the P2O5 will be further decomposed into phosphorus and residue called as phosphosilicate glass. This phosphosilicate glass will help us to trap the metal impurities from the silicon wafer. Once this process has been completed, in order to remove the phosphosilicate glass and the phosphorus deposited at the edges, we will do the process called edge isolation and phosphosilicate glass removal. This is the chemical process. We remove the edges chemically so that we will get the high shunt resistance and to get distinct p-n junction. Once the edge has been isolated, we will do the phosphosilicate glass removal in the same chemical bond. Once it is done, now the system is ready to create the electron hole pair when we put it in the sunlight. However, in order to increase the performance of the device, we do the anti-reflective coating by using plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposits. The anti-reflective coating will be deposited by using the combination of two gases, silane and ammonia, These two gases will react in a plasma medium and form silicon nitride and hydrogen as well. This silicon nitride acts as anti-reflective coating and reduces the reflection so that it helps to improve the current. However, the hydrogen generated during this process passivates the surface and crystallographic imperfection, which improves the lifetime of the carrier. This anti-reflective coating reduces the reflection from 30% to 4 to 5%. These silicon nitride deposited wafers also called as blue wafer. Now, the system is ready to create electron hole pair and it will work in its best level. In order to collect the charge carriers generated, we do the conventional screen printing to make a contact. In this process, we do the front contact and back contact printings. Aluminum and silver are the contact materials which we use for printing. This device, once it has been printed, the device will go for a drying in drying furnace. Once the drying completed, we do the process called metallization. The metallization is a process, very crucial process, which in the first step, the organic binders in the base, organic binders in the base will be burned up. Once it is done, at a slightly higher temperature, the glass fritz at the base will be melted and cleaves the silicon nitride so that we make the contact with the emitter. Now, the device is ready. However, we will check the electrical performance and the quality of the device in the solar simulator. By measuring current, voltage, and the help of area, we find it out the efficiency and structure of the cells. Now, before proceeding into the next session, I wanted to show you video on the complete process. So I will show you the video of the process. So this will give you the overall view of silicon solar cell process by using standard BSF technology. As I mentioned, the wafers are going for a process called solder damage and texturization. It's a chemical process. Once it is done, this will go for a process called doping and diffusion. Here we are creating a PN junction. Then we do the PSG removal and edge isolation. Here we do the anti-reflective coating, the silicon nitride coating. Now these cells are going for a printing and drying. This is a front contact printing, and now this is go for a metallization process. Once it is done, it will go for flash test, that is IV characterization, and from that we will get the efficiency of the cell.
Dr. Sarvanan,
yes.
We have a question. You mentioned something about the increase in the efficiency of the cell after anti-reflective coating. If you could just explain that to us again, how the processes are improving the efficiency of the cell in short.
See, the anti-reflective coating, that is nothing but the silicon nitride, helps to reduce the reflection of light from 20% to 4%. That means we are capturing more sunlight, which ultimately improves the current and the carrier lifetime. And thus, we are improving the efficiency of the solar cell.
Okay, so it prevents the reflection of the light, the anti-reflective coating, and that's how the efficiency of the cell goes up.
It captures more sunlight.
Captures more sunlight. Okay. Okay. Please proceed.
Now I request Mr. Bhupender Rawat to take it up for a couple of slides on wafer nomenclature and the Yamanuri procedure on black wafers and blue wafers.
Hello, friends. Hi. Am I audible? Hello?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So, friends, I think Dr. Sarbanan has already explained you the manufacturing process. Here we would like to specify something with respect to domestic content requirement, wherein MNRE has come out with a procedure wherein they have very, very clearly stated with respect to a clarification issued by them on 21st of October 2019. Wherein they specify that because the blue wafer is actually almost 60%, 70% processed wafer, actually it is already made into cell. Only the collection points are not printed and cell testing sorting has not happened. Actually, it is already processed into cell. So because of that, that blue wafers used into manufacturing of solar cells will not be considered under DCR, and they have very, very clearly mentioned that it has to be black undiffused wafer only, which is actually classified under tariff code 3818. If we use blue and black undiffused wafer to manufacture solar cells, then only it will be complying the DCR requirements. So the process made, showed you in the process which was showed you in the video, which by using blue wafer, actually you are eliminating all the processes which are texturization, diffusion, PSG removal, including the ARC coating. So all these processes are already avoided. So we wanted to specify here that we are the domestic cell manufacturers and it has to be black undiffused wafer only, which should be used under DCR category. So this is the classification clarification already issued by MNRE. Doctor?
Mr. Bhupender Rawat, just a quick question. So Mr. Venkatesh is asking us to just clarify about Renewcell. From which step we manufacture?
So we are using black undiffused wafers, which are actually classified under 3818, and then we are processing it. So we have the complete cell manufacturing process with us, where the input is black undiffused wafer. Is it clear?
Yes, yes, thank you.
So, next.
I think we can take it forward here.
Yeah, doctor, you can take it forward. Yeah.
Yeah. So, we have seen the process and manufacturing of advanced silicon PV technologies. Advanced PV cell technology has been devoted to increase the performance of solar cells, either from the material perspective or from the process perspective. This Advanced cell type have a different cell structure and the process flow compared to the standard aluminum BSL. However, it need an additional process steps compared to standard aluminum BSL. HJT is entirely different process steps compared to standard aluminum BSL. In a broader perspective, from the process perspective, in a broader process perspective, passivation is one of the key process parameter to achieve high efficiency cells. Also, optimizing the metallization process according to the passivation is an important criteria to achieve the high efficiency solar cells. So, the IBC cells fall in the silicon solar cell technology. It is an slightly exception from the passivation process. What is passivation? In order to understand the passivation, we will see the two important steps, which are the slicing process, two inherent defects, which are mostly on the surface of the wafer. This disruption of crystal lattice results dangling bonds, which access recombination centers so that the electrical performance will be low. Passivation is the process helps to defects inactive so that it reduces the surface recombination and safeguarding the cell efficiency at higher level. How we can do the passivation? We can do the passivation in two ways. One, saturating the dangling bonds by surface conditioning of silicon wafer, or by depositing hydrogen-rich dielectric film, and the free hydrogen saturate dangling bonds so that we can achieve the passivation. As discussed earlier, advanced cell technology concept arrived either from the material perspective or from the process perspective. From the process perspective, we have seen that the passivation is an additional process which supports to get a better efficiency. Similarly, the N-type wafer, that is the standard aluminum BSF technology, always use the P-type semiconductor wafer. Hence, the material researchers devoted their attention to an alternate to P-type, which is the N-type wafers, because the N-type has its own advantages, such as higher tolerance to metallic impurities and higher minority carrier lifetime of holes, and comparatively low LID because of boron oxygen complex. Passivated emitter rear contact solar cells. It's commonly known as PERC solar cells. This is the process flow of PERC solar cells. In order to differentiate the process of PERC cell, we have used two different colors. The different colors in the process steps. The processes which occurred in blue color is which we are doing in standard aluminum BSF technology also. For example, annealing and rear L2O3 deposition with silicon nitride capping, laser ablation, are the additional process steps in PERC solar cell. The cross-sectional view of PERC solar cell is as shown in this figure. PERC solar cells start with the P-type as the base wafer. The process passivation yield better efficiency compared to standard aluminum BSF technology. Now, let us have a look at PERC plus solar cells. PERC plus solar cells, this is the PERC family, this passivated emitter rear contact with bispecialty, that is four-side contact printing, as shown in the figure, is the major difference with the PERC and PERC plus. This also starts with the P-type base wafer. However, the additional processes like passivation and the bifacialty yielded better efficiency in PERC plus solar cells. This is the tunnel oxide passivated contact cell, commonly known as TOCON. This is the follow-up of PERC technology. The major difference between the PERC and PERC plus with the TOCON is the base wafer sorting is n-type wafer. The process flow of TOCON is as shown in the figure. Then the additional processes like tunnel oxide and polysilicon then along with the n-type wafer to the better efficiency in TOCON. PERC and PERL is subsequent to the PERC family, that is passivated emitter rear locally diffused cells, and this also start with the n-type base wafer, and the process passivation along with n-type wafer yield the better performance in PERL cell. Similarly, PERT is nothing but passivated emitter rear totally diffused cells. The schematic of PERT cell is as shown here. This is also the follow-up of PERC technology, and this also start with the n-type base wafer similar to TOCON. Most importantly, this is similar to PERC plus, that is a passivation with bifaciality, but the major difference is here we use the n-type wafer as the starting material. Now, interdigital direct contact cell, which commonly known as IBC cells, the process flow of IBC is as shown in the figure. Here too, we start with n-type base wafer. The major difference between the PERC family and the IBC is the IBC don't have the front contact. That means the 100% of light will be fall on surface and the top surface completely acts as active area. This is an added advantage of IBC along with n-type wafer. Now, we have completed the standard aluminum BSF technology and the different technologies under the class of standard homogeneous MTA technologies. Now, the next slide, we will go through with the heterojunction technology, HJT. The process looks simpler, but this is a difficult process. This also start with the n-type base wafer, and it has been arrived as a hybrid cell which combine the best qualities of crystalline silicon and amorphous silicon thin film so that it increases efficiency and the power output to higher levels. So this table gives you the current status of efficiency status and the challenges on different cell type or technology. Standard aluminum BSF technology, which use the p-type wafer, either mono or multi wafer, silicon wafer, the efficiency is in the range of 18% to 20%. This is the most proven technology. It is commercialized and prominent. However, it is slightly over efficiency compared to other technologies. Whereas PERC and PERC plus is similar to standard aluminum BSF technology. It is a start with the p-type wafer and uses mono and multi. The efficiency is in the range of 19.5 to 32.5. It is currently trending and commercialized due to the better performance. It can be upgraded with the existing standard aluminum BSF tools. TOCON, IBC, HJT, all these technologies start with the n-type mono wafer. In that, TOCON is commercially not available, including supply chain, but high capital investment due to higher efficiency. And IBC, IBC and HJT is a proprietary technology, hence the commercialized is hence not commercialized, although it's a high efficiency. So this is a slide gives the cell power output of different cell sizes and the higher number of bus bars. This clearly shows that the higher number of bus bars and the largest wafer size gives a better performance compared to the current cell. Thank you. The Renesis is a world-class product made in India. I request Vinayal will take care of it.
Thanks, doctor. So we have one question that has come in from Santosh. He's asking which one is higher efficiency, blue wafer or black wafer?
See, first thing I wanted to clarify that black wafer is the undiffused wafer. We cannot make the cell only with the black wafer. So the black wafer has to pass through that process which converts black wafer into blue wafer. So we cannot distinguish black wafer and the blue wafer.
Thank you. Another question that we have from Venkatesh again. If you could please explain the difference between a poly cell, a standard poly cell, and a PERC cell.
Well, see, the poly cell is not a poly cell. We can say as the BSF, standard aluminum BSF cell. See, the standard aluminum BSF cell don't have the passivation, is an additional process which helps to reduce the defects.
I think we have lost Dr. Sarvanand. He'll be rejoining us shortly. In the meanwhile, Sandeep, will you be able to just take this question for us? Difference between standard ALBSF cell and PERC cell?
No, I'll keep on, because I don't have the slides with me, Sarvanand has. I'll try to answer it. See, the basic difference is the amount of passivation you are doing. Okay, if you take a normal solar cell, from the top side, it is same. Okay, we generally call it as a vanilla process. For a vanilla solar cell and a PERC solar cell, on the front side, it is same. Now, whatever the changes we are making, we are doing on the back side. Okay, to reduce the recombinations or loss of electricity, whatever we are generating, basically the current, we use a field at the back in a normal vanilla process. In this, we chemically passivate using different types of materials, silicon nitride and all those, aluminum oxide, silicon nitride and all those. So the passivation is done better in PERC solar cells. That is the reason efficiency of the PERC solar cells is better compared to a vanilla process.
Okay, thanks.
So Vinayal, I think I just joined. I think I just heard one question. There was one question was wafer, which is more efficient, blue wafer,
yes,
or black wafer.
Yes.
So I think it's very important. I think that's the crux of this presentation. People should understand that is, basically speaking, is there's nothing called blue wafer. Blue wafer is nothing but a cell. So let me put it this way: a black wafer is nothing but the silicon ingot which has been sliced into a wafer. So a wafer on a standalone basis cannot produce electricity because it doesn't have a p-n junction form. Okay. So in order to form a p-n junction, you undergo a lot of processes like texturization, diffusion, doping, edge isolation, and so on and so forth. So after doing this, before you print the bus bars on it, that stage is called a blue wafer. So actually blue wafer is nothing but a cell. So wafer, a black wafer is not a cell. So from that point of view of, manufacturing cells, what is more important is if you're just going to take a blue wafer, then what you're doing is, you're just doing a printing. I mean, imagine is I have got a t-shirt manufacturing business. So if I'm importing just a t-shirts and putting a logo on the top of it, then am I manufacturing t-shirt or actually I'm buying a cloth and from there I'm stitching and then printing, that's what manufacturing t-shirts are concerned. So I mean, this was a very crude example. So efficiency, I think we have to understand this is a black wafer is not a cell. A blue wafer is a cell. So a blue wafer can produce electricity based upon the light, based upon the natural light what falls on it. Okay. Only after blue wafer, in order to trap the electrons which are formed, you form bus bars. So it becomes a useful cell, because just a blue wafer without printing the bus bars, you will not be in a position to commercially utilize it. So I think this is very important to understand, is black wafer is not a cell, but blue wafer is a cell, but it is bus bars.
Okay. Another question, so in follow-up to that, is that if we are manufacturing from black wafers from this stage, then why is there a price difference between Chinese cells and Indian BCR cells?
Could you just repeat the question, Vinay?
Yes, sir. So a follow-up to this is that if we are manufacturing cells from wafers, from black wafers,
right,
then why is there a difference in the end price of the Indian cell, Indian DCR cell versus Chinese cells?
Yeah, basically, I think there are two or three reasons to this. Is number one, if I just look at it, the scales, the scales what, for example, China has one cell line will be of 10 gigawatts. And maybe in India, the maximum cell line what we have is 1 gigawatt. And generally speaking, other cell lines are in the range of 100 to 200 megawatts. So you can imagine is, if you have a 100, 200 megawatt cell line versus 10 gigawatt cell line is, obviously speaking, is the scales what you have makes a difference from the point of view. Number one is, the manufacturing overheads are kind of per megawatt half of what India has because of the scales. Number two, the buying power is much better. You are in a position to actually speaking get in material at a better discount because you got huge volumes to buy. So this is the advantage on scales. Okay. Number two is if you look at it, is the outsourcing or the ecosystem. For India to buy any of the raw materials for manufacturing cells, whatever are requiring all these chemicals, etc., the silver paste and all these things, we have to depend again on China itself. Where is the Chinese companies? It's all local for them. So from that point of view, for them, the inventory carrying costs are very low. That means is if I want some material, now I can place the order right away, and within 2 days I can get the material. So the supplier is managing the stock. But in India, if I want to do that, I have to take the sailing time and all. So I had to order this maybe 60 days in advance or 30 days in advance. So my inventory is also high, based upon which my inventory carrying cost also gets added. And the third point is the local infrastructure, because a cell, manufacturing cell is quite power intensive, and the cost of electricity in India is very high as compared to that of China, because China can maybe, because China has a very lower cost of energy. Industries get energy at the cost of maybe three and a half rupees a unit, where in India, actually speaking, it works out to be anywhere in the range of 8 rupees plus. So these are basically the factors by which you find that the costs manufacturing in India are higher as compared to that in China.
Okay, thank you, sir. We have a question now from Yatin. Dr. Sarvanan, I think this one is for you. Since the patent for HJT has expired, do you expect more manufacturers to come up with HJT and for it to become more mainstream?
Yes, absolutely. It will be.
And could you give us some examples of cell manufacturers who make HJT cells?
No, it is not ready. It is in the pipeline.
Okay, fair enough. Another question that we have is from Mr. Murli Krishna. What is the maximum efficiency in standard poly cells?
Maybe I would... just answer the agility question. See, agility question, yes, I mean, patents are expired. So obviously speaking, the demand is expected to pick up. But however, agility, there are still question marks on commercialization of it because it's still on a wait and watch kind of a thing. Is I think REC has already has invested in HJT. People are trying to evaluate how the performance will be, and if it's fine, it's commercially working out well and viable, then I think there will be more people investing in HJT. But to the best of our knowledge in India so far, there are no talks of HJT. Whatever has happened right now is REC is doing it on a, I think to my knowledge, it's about 600 megawatt cell line on HJT. So it's kind of a wait and watch.
Okay, thank you. So going back to the wafer discussion again, I think we have a couple of people who still require a sort of clarification on the difference between blue wafer and black wafer. Just to quickly summarize, black wafer is the raw wafer which cannot be used as is. Blue wafer is produced after several steps, and therefore we cannot
Hello.
Vinay, your voice is not there.
Yeah, doctor, can you hear me?
Yeah. I can, sir.
Yes, yeah. I'm sorry, I just lost the network for a little bit.
Okay.
Also, so going back, yes, sorry.
Let me once again, I think this is the kind of being asked over and over again. For a cell, you need to have a PN junction. A wafer on its own, doesn't have a PN junction. It is absolutely raw. So wafer is a black wafer is without a PN junction. You have to form a PN junction. Okay, and there is a process involved. Okay. Now a blue wafer is nothing but actually a cell with PN junction formed. So blue wafer is nothing but cell. It is not cell manufacturing. A black wafer, is actually the raw material by which you can actually produce a cell. Okay, and blue wafer is one of the second last step. After blue, black wafer gets converted into blue wafer by going through 3-4 steps, like texturization, diffusion, doping, edge isolation, etc. Okay, you form a blue wafer, and the blue wafer, then you put those what you call bus bars, then it becomes a commercial cell. But blue wafer, a PN junction is formed. Please note that a blue wafer, a PN junction is already formed. So blue wafer is nothing but cell. So you cannot use blue wafer as as a raw material for producing cell because it's already a cell. So it is not so if people are trying to evaluate it as a made in India cell, it is not, because you are already importing the blue wafer from outside. That means you are already buying cell from outside, you're just printing it. So I hope the difference is clear.
Okay, sir, thank you. Going to our next question. What is the highest efficiency that we can currently expect in standard multi-cell?
The expected multi efficiency in standard, it is in the range of 19 to 19.5.
okay, thank you. And let me just quickly check if we have any more questions coming in. Dr. Sarvanan, if you can just quickly explain once again how HJT cells are different from regular cells, our listeners would like to know.
See, heterojunction technology is entirely the different technology compared to the PERC or standard aluminum BSF technology, because the standard aluminum BSF technology and the PERC process deals with the anti-reflective coating, contact printing, everything. Whereas the heterojunction technology is the cell combination of the crystalline silicon and the amorphous silicon. That is the hybrid cell. That is the major difference of HJT and the PERC or standard aluminum BSF technology cell. Hope this is okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Doctor. And so from all the technologies that we've covered today, Mr. Yash Doshi is asking us, which would you say is the highest in terms of efficiency?
See, as I listed in the last slide, currently in that TOPCon plays the major role in the efficiency. And however, the commercially available monoper plus and monoper plays the dominant role in efficiency wise.
Okay.
And still,
yes, please continue.
Yeah, tell me.
So another question that we have is HIT and HJT different? Are they two different types of cells?
No, but that's it.
I'm just quickly going through the questions once again. So we have a question here about energy consumption for cell production. So what the question is basically, how much energy is consumed to produce 1 megawatt of cells? Just an overall understanding. Will we be able to take that question?
Sorry to say that, I am not able to answer for that.
And another question, we've gone back to DCR. What is the difference between a DCR cell and a non-DCR cell?
Yeah, I can take that. So basically, DCR as it as the name says, suggests, that is domestic content requirement. So DCR cell is basically a cell which is, you make it by importing black wafer as your raw material, and then you put it through all the steps what's been shown in doctor's presentation that talks about texturization, doping, diffusion, edge isolation, okay, and then printing to make it a cell. So if you are using black wafer as your input, okay, for manufacturing cell, then it gets qualified as DCR. But if you are importing directly cells from China or any other country, or you are importing blue wafer and just printing busbars, that is not recognized as DCR.
Noted, sir. Thank you. Sarvanan, our next question is on bifacial cells from Gautam. He's asking if you can just quickly re-explain the difference between standard cells and bifacial cells.
See, the difference between the standard BSF technology and the bifacial cell, the bifacial will have the front contact grid pattern at both the sides. And it will access, that means both the sides to work as a solar cell. That is the bifacial.
Okay, just to answer this, I think his audio is not clear. Doctors, I mean, some problem. You see, we have to understand this is as the name suggests, a standard cell is normally only one phase of the cell produce electricity. Okay, I mean, I'm answering in a very layman's language. Only one phase of the cell is producing electricity. Okay, the one which is exposed to the sun. Okay, now in a bifacial, both the faces produce electricity. That is, a cell has got the front face and the back face. Okay, so generally speaking, in a standard cells, you know, the back side is normally covered with a back sheet. Okay, which is not a transparent back sheet. Okay. So generation is, because it's only the front side which is generating, which is facing the cell, you get electricity only from front face. Now in a bifacial, as both the sides has the ability of producing electricity. So the question is, on the back side, how do I ensure light also falls? So for that, either number one is, either the back sheet has to be a transparent back sheet, or also the back side, you have to replace the back sheet with the glass. Okay. Number two, you know, you have to also ensure that the ground below has got some reflection. That means, you know, you can actually put in some white pebbles, or you can paint it white. So whatever sunlight passes through and falls on the ground, okay, below the panels, it gets reflected back. And that light gets, converted into the electricity from the backside. So based upon that, from the same module, a bifacial cell or a bifacial module will generate more electricity, because it is in a position to entrap lights at two stages. One is the front face and also on the back face. But obviously speaking, the back face efficiency is not as much as front face, because the reflection coming from the back is comparatively limited. So maybe, you know, on an average, one can produce about 8 to 10% more, based upon whatever experiments have been done by people. Okay, about 8 to 10% more from a bifacial as compared to a monofacial.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So we have another question from Mr. Palraj. He is asking us, why is there a difference in cell colors? So between various mono cells and various multi cells, we see a difference in the intensity of the color. Some of them appear almost blackish. Some of them appear a more brilliant blue. Why is there that color difference between cells?
Yeah, I will take it up, that one. See, now the screen which is shown itself, you can see the difference between the mono and multi. If in general, the silicon nitride coating deposited in the mono wafer, it will be looks like a more darker color, whereas in multi, it won't look like that. And also, then in the same mono or multi, you will get the wide range, with a starting from, as he said, it's a dark blue and medium blue or light blue. This is the process variation, but it is the aesthetical look. It never plays the role with the performance of the cell. It basically depends on the silicon nitride, what we deposited over the silicon.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, doctor. And I believe at Renewcis, we also sort cells as per color.
Yes, of course, we also sort out the cells according to the color. We have the three varieties of color. Only our color bin is very narrow, as because of the process window is narrow. We have only light blue, medium blue, and dark blue.
Okay, so that is primarily for the aesthetic appeal of the panel. Performance wise, that doesn't really make a difference.
No, it won't make much difference with respect to the colors.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, doctor. The next question that we have is from Mr. Yatin Shah. He says, since cells are treated and then encapsulated in the panel, how can a buyer or the government ensure that the cells used in a DCR module are actually DCR cells and the manufacturer is not using imported cells and branding them as DCR?
So, Bhupendra, can you take this piece?
Yeah. So, basically, it is to do with the documentation and then traceability. So when you talk about documentation, the first and foremost document which is provided by a manufacturer is a self-declaration, which gives in the details of you know what he is whether he has self-consumed it, the cell is produced by him and self-consumed, or he has outsourced it. If he has outsourced it, he can always give some reference of his cell buying. So that is one way, because this is to do with documentation. Plus, now MNRE has come out with another set of documentation, which also speaks about the mass balance statement. Now, this mass balance statement is to do with the input and output. Like in wafer, in solar cell manufacturing, we are going to use black and diffuse silicon wafer. So how much of the raw material imported, how much is consumed and converted into cell, and from that cell, what you have captively used and what you have sold outside. So this all information will be captured in the mass balance statement and will be submitted to MNRE on a monthly basis. So that centrally they can monitor that. Plus, as far as the customers or direct customers are concerned, for them, there is also a third party inspection, which is called PDI in our case, pre-dispatch inspection. During that stage, the inspector is also looking at the traceability documents. So like I said, this MBS will be, mass balance statement will be available in the plant level. Whenever he's doing this inspection, he can always verify those documents as well. So is it clear?
Thank you. We have another question here on the efficiency of cells. Is it true that Indian cells are generally of a lower efficiency in comparison to Chinese cells? And are cells graded as A, B, and C depending on their efficiency and quality?
Yes. Each and every cells will be graded according to the this one A or B grade. C grade, I don't think so. But B, it depends on the manufacturer to manufacturer, depending on their quality parameters, A and B. And I am not sure about the question on the variation between the Chinese efficiency and Indian, because even we are at currently, we are at also the good level of around 18.75 in a multi-cell.
Yeah, so maybe I'll answer this question, Dr. On the grading part of it, yeah, normally speaking, there are two grades of cell, A and B, and then it has got nothing to do with efficiency. It is more from the point of view of the quality characteristics. So I think so that's how A grade cells are normally having a better quality. B grade cells are normally the quality is not as good, and quality is not necessary efficiency. There might be so many other things like color. There might be visual appearances. There might be something to do with micro cracks and so on and so forth. So as far as efficiency is concerned, it is more of technology. It's technology driven. Is what kind of machinery you have. So I mean, you cannot draw a parallel saying that China is better than India or vice versa, or India better than China. I think it all depends on what line you have. How well the line is synchronized. How skillful are the people who are actually speaking, converting the wafers into cells? So it's a mix of that. And as doctor said, in India, we are finding that efficiency levels, what we have, because I will tell you is, for example, is when we started our cell line, we started with an, kind of an efficiency, we were told we'll be in a position to achieve average of 17.5 or something of that sort. But within 1 year, that the Renewables team has been in the position to bring the efficiency higher, the mean efficiency in the range of 18.6, 18.7. So when I say 18.6, 18.7, that doesn't mean that all the cells are 18.6, 18.7. So you normally get a spread from 18.3 to 19.1. And we find this spread is kind of equivalent to what's happening in China. So if that answers your question.
Yes, sir. Thank you. We have another question from Flame Solvin. What is the major difference between p-type and n-type wafers, and which type has a higher efficiency?
One minute. Can you come back to question again?
Yes. What is the major difference between p-type and n-type, and which has a higher efficiency?
See, as I presented in this, the p-type and n-type are difference depending on the doping material, and compared to p-type, n-type is the best candidate because of the high threshold called metal impurities and higher concentration of minority carriers, and the comparatively low LID with p-type.
Okay, I'm just quickly going through these questions that we're receiving again. One of the questions that we have got.
One second. I think it was an important question, but somehow doctor's side is the audio is not very clear. I couldn't hear him well. So Sandeep, would you like to take this p-type and n-type?
Basically. In both the types, we have pure silicon initially. Okay, then to make the solar cells, the wafers are being doped. Okay, with what we are doping, we'll decide whether it is a p-type or an n-type. Okay, suppose if you are doping with boron, it is called as a p-type, and if you dope with phosphorus, then it is called as an n-type. Generally, electrons will have higher lifetime compared to holes. So solar cell made using an n-type wafer will have higher efficiencies. That is the reason if you see the TOPCon technologies or PERT technology, the latest upcoming technologies use n-type wafer, even the back contact cells, back contact technologies, IBC technology also has n-type wafer. So n-type wafer is obviously better in terms of efficiencies. Why, how is it classified is what doping material you are using. Are you using boron or phosphorus? If you use phosphorus, it is n-type. If you use boron, it is p-type.
Fine, Sandeep, thank you.
Thank you, Sandeep. The next question that we have is about Renusys cells. Renusys consumes, do we consume our own cells in most of our panels, or what is the spread? That is the question that has come.
Yeah, maybe I'll answer that. See, Renusys has got a total module capacity of 750 megawatts, and the cell line capacity is 130. So obviously speaking, Renusys has to also import cells from other countries in order to manufacture, to take care of the complete manufacturing of the plant. So on an average, based upon this, is you can say about 70% is our cells are imported, and 30% are made locally at the factory.
Thank you, sir. Another question that we have, I think that you can take for us from Mr. Palraj is, are there any wafer manufacturing setups in India, or are there any expected wafer manufacturing setups in India?
No, I think this question was basically also asked last time, but it was kind of the values chain. But I need to explain this is just wafer manufacturing in India doesn't make sense, because wafer is nothing but slicing. Okay, the main thing is the ingot. Okay, and the ingot is a very power intensive process. I mean, if you are manufacturing ingot, about 40 to 50% of the raw material cost, but nothing but power cost. So ingot manufacturing is always at places where the cost of power is very, very cheap. I mean, where cost of power is in the range of 1.5-2 rupees, or it's only dedicated with a very cheap hydropower. So China, where in those municipalities areas or those regions where the cost of power is in the range of 1.5-2 rupees, that's where ingot plants have been situated. So what happens is that once you actually make the ingot, then it's only a slicing process, because you then slice it into bricks and you slice it into wafers. So normally speaking, the entire value chain from ingot to wafer is normally taken by only one company. There is no point in, you know, making ingot there, bringing it here and slice it, because it's a waste. Second thing we have to also understand is, whenever you slice wafer, there's also a lot of dust. Okay. Now, you know, in places like China, normally you can recycle the dust, so you put it back into the process. But in India, if you're just going to make wafers and dust, you know, you get a dust, what will you do? So the cost of also just slicing wafers, becomes too expensive, and it doesn't make any commercial sense. So the wafer can only come into India provided the ingots comes into India. So I think, and that's a also investment wise, it's one of the most expensive investment of the entire value chain from silicon to cells. So considering that, India has to have a totally different ecosystem in order to attract investments for ingots and wafers. I hope it clarifies.
Thank you, sir. That definitely helped. Another question we have related to multi-busbar cells is, what is the benefit of moving to multi-busbar cells and how?
Sandeep, can you just take this? What's the benefit of multi-busbar? Because I think it's more from the point of a module side than on the cell manufacturing.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, there are couple of things actually. Okay, I'll divide it into a couple of things. First, the simpler one, cell one, I'll finish, and then I'll go for the module one. Cell-wise, actually, what happens is, the more the number of bus bars, the less amount of distance the charge carries, that is, electron has to travel. Okay, that is the advantage what we have from the cell point of view. Second advantage in the cell point of view is the amount of shading. Basically, silver, what we have on the top side is opaque. So by increasing the number of busbars and reducing the width, the total amount of shaded area due to silver busbar comes down, thereby increasing the efficiency.
Sandeep, sorry to stop you. There's actually a little disturbance, so we can't hear you clearly.
Okay. I'll repeat. Vinal, 1 minute.
Yes, yes.
I'll divide the answer into two parts, one from the cell point of view, other from the module point of view. From the cell point of view, the advantage is, there are two advantages basically. The first one is the distance that generated electrons have to travel will come down, thereby increasing the efficiency. That is the first part. And second part from the cell is, reduction in the shaded region on the cell, because generally silver is opaque. The more amount of silver you have, the less amount of active area over the cell. So by making it into multi bus bar, we are increasing the number of bus bars, at the same time reducing the shaded region. So more amount of region is available for the light to fall on, which would be useful for energy generation. Okay, so both the cases in cell, it will increase the output of the solar cell. Second, coming to a module point of view, since the bus bars are very thin, instead of using a flat ribbon, we need to use wires for making the solar modules. While we are using wires, since they are circular in shape, the light which is falling onto the ribbons or the interconnecting copper what we are using, since it is in circular shape, it will reflect back onto the module, thereby decreasing the CTM loss of a solar module, increasing the power of the module. And one more advantage is, since more number of bus bars are there, even if you have a crack or a micro crack, still that piece of a solar cell is connected to the circuit, without contributing to heating. Suppose if that isolated part due to micro crack or crack is isolated, it is generating, but it is not getting collected. Since we have multi bus bars, the energy generated in that region will also be collected. These are the advantages of multi bus bar over a conventional 5 bus bar or a 4 bus bar cell.
Thank you, Sandeep. The next question we have is related to CTM loss. Is there a greater CTM loss in DCR cells than in other cells? With a yes or no?
It does not matter whether it is a DCR cell or is it a cell from China. As long as the technology is same, the CTM losses will remain same.
Okay. Thank you, Sandeep. And in follow-up to that, is there some way to test incoming wafers to check for wafer quality so that prior to manufacturing DCR cells, we ascertain the quality of the cells that are going to be manufactured?
Yeah, you can take it up. See, each and every cell manufacturers will have their own quality criteria for incoming wafer inspection. In the same way, we have our own specifications to check the incoming wafers. Like for example, in order to avoid the more breakages, we will look at the thickness of the wafer, and in order to take it up the electrical performance, we check the quality parameter called seat resistance. If these parameters meet our specifications, then only it will go for the cell process.
Okay, thank you Dr. Sarvanan. The last question that we have for today is basically, what is the difference between cells in mono modules and in multi modules? If you could just quickly explain that once again.
See, mono modules will have the mono cells, and multi modules will have the poly cells. The question is, it is not like, is there any difference between cells of and the poly module? Only the power will be the difference. That depends on the mono is better than the poly cell.
Okay, thank you. So I'm just asking a follow-up once again to that. If there is any difference in their performance in India between multi and mono, this is on the module front. Are both modules going to perform equally well across India?
I'm taking it, sir. Last time also we had the same question. What actually the thing is, see, the mono cells what we are talking are of different technology, and the multi-cell what we are talking is of a different technology. The multi-cell what we are talking is a normal BSF, and whereas mono what we are talking is a PERC cell. Okay, the temperature coefficients of a PERC cell are much better compared to that of a BSF cell. So in terms of whether it is mono or multi does not impact, but it is the technology which we are using in a cell. The PERC technology has lower temperature coefficient, so they tend to perform slightly better compared to a normal BSF technology. It is not from mono or multi. If the technology for mono and multi is same, the performance would be same. But normally mono modules what we are having are PERC, so they will be performing better because of the PERC technology.
Okay, thank you. The last question for today is, if backsheet quality and encapsulin quality actually affects cell performance in a module, will one of us be able to
it's a question, right? Will it impact or not?
Yes.
Okay. In terms of power generation, the effect is not so high, but from the reliability point of view, we should be very careful in choosing the encapsulant material as well as the backsheet. Generally, we have a backsheet where we try to avoid any water vapor or humidity coming into the coming in contact with the solar cells. And at the same time, we use encapsulant material which is suitably transparent enough so that maximum light goes inside. And at the same time, it is providing suitable mechanical cushion to the solar cells so that it won't damage, but it is having the mechanical strength. Suppose if your backsheet is not proper or not good, you can see cracking of the backsheets, chalking of the backsheets, and yellowing of the backsheet. Primarily because of the composition of the backsheet what we are using, And if we have an EVA on the top side, basically if the EVA is not proper, they will allow UV light to pass through. UV light tend to damage both EVA as well as the back sheet. So yes, they do have, but not in terms of performance initially. It is on the reliability point of view or the longevity point of view of the module, which they play a factor.
Thank you so much, Sandeep. And I'd like to thank all our participants as well. I'll just quickly introduce our panel once again for those of you who missed the introduction. Today we had with us Mr. Nandkumar Pai, who is the CEO of Cells and Modules for Renusys. We had Dr. Sarvanan, who heads the semiconductor research at Renusys. We have Sandeep, who leads reliability for modules. And we have Mr. Bhupendra Rawat, who heads business development. I'd like to thank all of you all for joining us. And we will most probably be announcing our next webinar in a day or so. It will definitely be happening next week, so please stay tuned. And we will be uploading the video of this webinar on our website as well. So in case you all had a spotty connection or would want to revisit it, it's definitely going to be up there on the website. With that, I'd like to conclude this webinar. Thank you, friends. Thank you for joining us. And we hope to see you again soon. Have a nice day.
Thank you.
Thank you.